These are the camshafts of a 2GR-FE. This is the exhaust camshaft. This is the intake camshaft. And you have similar camshafts on the other bank. In this video, we're going to take a look inside these variable valve timing gears and see how they operate. It's pretty easy to take the gears off the camshafts. They are just bolted in from the front. And unlike some other VVT systems on other cars, this bolt is not the OCV. Okay, it's not the oil control valve. This is just a simple straight bolt. So both cam gears can come off the camshafts pretty easily. So here we have our cam gears. The first thing you'll note is that these bolts on the front have some kind of pattern that I've never seen before. I don't know where to get a tool to mesh this pattern. Now, for the exhaust gear, it's not so difficult to use vice grip pliers and unfasten these bolts. For the intake gear, it's a little bit harder, but we're going to try to do it for the intake gear because I've never seen one of these disassembled by anybody. People always disassemble the exhaust gear because it's easier. This is the exhaust gear. And as I said, this one is pretty easy to disassemble. You don't need any special tool. You can just take it apart with some vice grips to break these bolts loose. And then the bolts, once they're broken real loose, they're very easy to turn. Okay, now flip this over, the bottom comes off. And we can see a few things here. The first thing is the lock pin. This is the pin that engages when the engine stops. And then when you start the engine again, it keeps the gear locked in place so it does not rattle. Okay, because until you build up oil pressure, this gear will rattle. Now, you can see that this is in the position of maximum advance. And the oil pressure builds up on one side and moves the gear to retard the opening and closing of the exhaust valves. Now, this gear is built such that this spring on the outside is always returning it to its locked position. So you may have noticed that when I pry it loose like this, okay, it just comes right back. And that's because of this spring mechanism right here. Now, this spring mechanism was a weak point on some of the early exhaust gears, and this collar could break off. And when it breaks off, it moves in contact with the timing gear, with the timing cover, I mean. I'll show you some pictures what that looks like. This is an example shown in the car with the collar in contact with the timing cover. Here's what it looks like with the gear removed. And eventually, if this moves far enough, the entire camshaft jams and you incur some serious engine damage. Let's look at a couple of other things. This vane right here acts as the mechanical stop. So it limits the degree of return of the vanes. So when it comes back until this comes into contact. Then it stops. And here you can see the oil passages that engage with the camshaft. Camshaft has oil passages in it that match up with these passages right here. And that's how oil pressure can build up right here on this side. Okay, and it advances. And then it's the spring on the back, not the oil pressure, that returns this gear to its lock position. This is the locking pin that it locks against this orifice right here, and oil pressure can build up through this passage, and it comes up and pushes this down to unlock it. So these are the features of the exhaust gear. Next, we're going to look at the intake gear. We're done with the exhaust camshaft, with the exhaust cam gear. So let's look at the intake cam gear. And the first thing you notice right from the outside is that this cam gear, and maybe you can't see this from the outside, this cam gear only has three lobes, unlike the exhaust cam gear, which has four lobes. This has three lobes. Okay, the other thing is it has this kind of a weird balancing wheel that's on the top. And while disassembling this off camera, I came to the conclusion that you cannot really take this gear apart unless you pry this balance wheel off. So I went ahead and did that. I also sacrificed the bolts that it had on it. Okay, and I just replaced them with standard head bolts. So the three bolts come out. Now we can look inside. And here is pretty clear that you have three lobes. Okay, I've already unlocked this. When you look from this side, there is no visible locking pin. Okay, the locking pin is down on the other side. So I've unlocked it already, and you can see that it moves back and forth. And now I'm going to pop it out. Oh, yeah, one more thing. This right here, this is the mechanical stop. This gives the maximum advance. Okay, and then moving forward again, we go to the rest position where the pin will engage. Right here, you heard it click and engage into place. Let's see what this pin looks like. Let's take a look. Now, when I take this apart, these sort of little lubricating bits of, I think they're Teflon. I don't know. They're going to fall off. And you just keep track of them. But here is the locking pin. And it's spring activated. And it goes down into this hole. And you can see the passage for oil to enter and disengage the pin. Right here, this little passage is for oil to push this pin back so that the gear can rotate. Now, I'm not going to bother with putting these sliders back in right now. They're just a real pin. They have little leaf springs. Every slider has a little leaf spring that keeps it pressed in place. So they're a little bit tedious, especially when you have old arthritic fat fingers like mine. But you can get this into place if you work it enough there. So that goes in place. This spring part goes against the body of the rotor and this plastic piece, which provides lubrication, we suppose, that goes against the inside of the body. Okay, so nothing special about this pin. It has a nice clean action. And, you know, when you rotate it, it just provided that there's downward pressure. The lock's in place. Now it would take oil pressure coming down in there to push it back up enough so that this can be lifted and rotate. So unlike the exhaust cam gear, which relies on spring pressure for the return, this one relies on oil pressure in both directions, and that's controlled by the OCV, of course, which is controlled by the ECU. And I've put some thought into this, why it's necessary to have a spring on the exhaust, but no spring needed on the intake. And that's because of the direction of rotation. Okay, on the exhaust, you want to try to retard the opening as much as possible. And you can do that with hydraulic pressure, but then to bring it back the other way is really hard because the gear is turning at the same time. Okay. Whereas on this one, it's easy to bring it back because of the direction of rotation of the camshaft. All right, I hope that makes sense. So just another look. This is it. And that's all there is to it. I hope that you enjoyed this video. Thank you very much for watching, and look forward to seeing your comments and suggestions in the description.